Welcome to Connie Martinson Talks Books. If you have been looking for a book that will keep you up late at night, a novel that doesn't stop, I have a book for you. It's written by my guest, Neil Cross. It is called Luther, The Calling, and it's published by Touchstone, Simon & Schuster. Welcome, Neil.
Oh, thank you very much. Nice to be here.
And Luther is John Luther, and he is a detective in London, mm-hmm. and he is a man who is hard on himself, to say the least.
Yeah. He's actually, the novel Luther, The Calling, is a prequel to a television show, which I wrote and created, wherein the character of John Luther is played by Idris Elba, who's maybe best known here from The Wire, where he played Stringer Bell, this kind of iconic character in The Wire. And he came back to London to play John Luther. So the novel, although it's a standalone novel, and although you need no knowledge whatsoever of the TV series in order to read and hopefully enjoy, and even more hopefully be kept awake late at night by the novel, it is related to the TV show.
He is a man who will beat up a criminal on the side, and he has to be careful because his boss, Teller, is not unaware of his proclivities to, torture.
Yeah, he's a man on a very short rope. I like the idea that the notion of the troubled detective is not unfamiliar from both literature and the screen. But I like the idea of somebody who's troubled not by the consequences of the job chafing against his personal life, but somebody who's involved in what he sees as kind of really moral process. That it's got less to do with law and order, where John Luther is concerned, than with pure notions of right and wrong.
He almost would have done well as a priest.
Absolutely. I think that's a very, very accurate summation of his essential character. And I think he would have been happier as a priest and more suited to that job.
Sort of a Savonarola.
Yes. Yeah. But he's disqualified, I think, although it's something we didn't explore very much in the show. It's something I wrote about a lot in the development of the show. In that he's a man who desperately wants there to be form in the universe and desperately wishes there were some kind of moral order to the universe, but doesn't feel able to believe in God.
The story that propels him in this book is are two people who have been abducting babies and killing them. And how do they do it? I mean, that I have visions of you sitting at your desk and sort of saying, okay, how did they get the keys? Well, how did they get the keys? There was a cleaning woman, mm-hmm. and she had all the keys to everybody's apartment, and that is how they got the keys.
I've got a friend who's a long-time member of the Metropolitan Police Force, and he spent the last 15, 17 years as a murder detective, and one of the greatest and most fearsome compliments I've ever been paid is that he told me I'd make a very fine criminal. But I think that's probably in common with many, many writers, is that you get to sit in the safety of your office, wherever you may work, at your kitchen table or in the spare bedroom or in your garage, and you have this kind of inordinate pleasure of being able to pretend to be one of these people who exist in this kind of moralist and evil universe. I think, if I were that kind of person, how would I achieve this? And I do get massive amounts of fun out of doing that.
Well, the main killer in this is a man named Henry. And he functions in a way that in the summer he will wear cutoffs. And in the winter he dresses strictly almost Savile Row. Mm-hmm. And he has a boy with him who he refers to as his son, and he beats the living life out of this poor baby who's 16, is afraid to go off on his own against him until a point, and he must follow orders, and it is always to kill, to maim, to almost drink blood.
Mm-hmm. We are kind of culturally, we've become incredibly conversant in the ways of serial killers. It's something we've witnessed via literature and television and cinema for, I guess, 20, 25 years now. Thomas Harris really kicking it off. And so it's a great challenge. I like those stories. I like that kind of story. But it's a great challenge to, in the light of this wide knowledge that we have of how these people think and how they operate and what they do, it's a fabulous challenge to step back and try to create the most frightening killer you possibly can. And that's the greatest joy that I get, is to sit down with a nice cup of tea and try to work out how I'm able to frighten people the most effectively.
Well, probably the most frightening is the thought you are fast asleep in your home. You thought you had locked all the doors, and unbeknownst to you, someone could come in and watch you and your husband or lover sleep, and then go out without maybe doing mayhem,
mm-hmm.
or the opposite. And in the opposite, with a couple named Lambert,
mm-hmm.
they murder them,
mm-hmm.
cut their heads off, which, you know, we read about happening in Mexico, and you think, oh, it couldn't, but it's happening in this book.
There's something particularly, I don't think it's a profound thought on my part, but there is something innate and profound about the invasion of the home. The home is where you are most protected, and also where it is your obligation to protect your loved ones and your children and your spouse and maybe your parents. And there is something kind of just innately terrifying of to consider the fact that this place, in fact, although to you it's sacrosanct, it's just a house. And people like this can come and go as they please if they're clever enough and essentially evil enough. I find that, again, that I only ever write about the scary stuff I write about things which frighten me.
Well, the other is poor Bill, older man. He has his dog he loves. And he is in a house where the owner wants to get him out. I can make more money. Why don't you go to a nursing home? And he's six on this old man, two boys or two men who are out of Clockwork Orange.
That's true. And I've been dragged across the coals by my friends and certain members of my publishers for the great unkindness that I visit upon dogs via these men. I don't know what it is. I seem to have a compulsion in novels to do unpleasant things to dogs, which is strange because I love dogs. I have two dogs, and there's nothing I like more than a dog. But so some repressed urge is expressing itself somehow.
Yeah. What sort of dogs do you have?
I've got a Parsons Jack Russell, which is the taller of the Jack Russell breeds.
Uh-huh.
And he's unique in as much as that Jack Russells famously are very intelligent dogs. And I have probably the only unintelligent Jack Russell in the entire world. He's about as far from intelligent as it's possible for a dog to be. And his older brother, the older dog, is an Australian Terrier, who's a kind of, if you could imagine something which is twice the size of a Yorkshire Terrier, but looks essentially like a Yorkshire, like a tough
Neil,
Yorkshire Terrier.
You also write this book as in a way, as if it were a screenplay.
Mm-hmm.
You sort of go away from being the author to being the director, mm-hmm. saying she would do X, Y, and Z at that point. As a result, the reader feels they're having a movie in their mind.
Oh, I'd take that as an enormous compliment. That was a deliberate contrivance, or at least it's something I very, very much wanted to achieve. I love books where you do feel like you're in the middle of the action, and you never, to me, I like books that are written such that you never have to reread a sentence. And however beautiful and elegant a sentence may be, if you have to reread it in order to understand its sense, then it's neither beautiful nor elegant. And I think one of the greatest pleasures of reading, and I read a great deal, I spend more of my life reading than probably I should, but one of the greatest pleasures of reading is to forget that you're reading while you're reading. And that was my intent, very much so.
Is your wife a reader?
Oh, yeah, my wife's a huge reader.
Yeah.
And, sorry, go on.
Growing up, where were you born, and did you go to college there?
I was born in, I had a very complicated childhood, which kind of slightly feeds into the serial killer element in this book. I was born in the West Country in Bristol. I was the youngest by far of three siblings. My oldest, the younger of my siblings was 11 years older than me. I was actually raised in Edinburgh by a man called Derek Cross, whose name I took. I lived in Edinburgh with him, I guess, from the ages of 6 to 13. And he was this kind of fantastically dapper little man with a God-shaped hole in him. He was, and still is, the angel on one shoulder and the demon on the other. I was from a very ordinary working class family. We had no books in the house, not even the kind of traditional Bible that all families have. My father would get the local newspaper every morning, and that was it. And I was a freakish and bookish little kid in a family and a culture that was not at all bookish. My stepfather, Mr. Cross, was the most incredibly bookish man. And one of the, although we lived in a horrible Victorian tenement that had been declared unfit for human habitation, one of the first things he ever did for me, having learned that I'd like to read, was come home with a carrier bag full of Victorian children's classics. And he proceeded to read to me every night. And he was the most remarkably fantastic stepfather in that he shone the absolute focus and light of his attention on me as a young boy. And having grown up by that point with stepchildren and a stepmother and being pushed to the sidelines, to exist in the focus of that kind of love when you're that age as a boy is the most incredible thing. But the thing about Derek Cross is that, as well as being, you know, the most fabulous stepfather you can imagine, and, you know, the most fabulous man in many ways, he was also, I think, some kind of high-functioning psychopath, and he was a white supremacist, and he moved from, he was a white South African white supremacist. He wasn't just a racist. This was the kind of the real thing. And he moved through life shedding identities. Not literally, he never changed his name, but I think he kind of found some self-affirmation by making people love him, and making people fall in love with him. And the kind of focus of that beam that he shone down upon people that he loved, in fact, was a mirror. It was reflecting back at him, and it made him feel whole and special. But eventually it dimmed, and he'd spent his whole life moving from relationship to relationship, marrying, breaking up families, bringing up children, dumping children. And he was a thief, and he arranged armed robberies. And
could he have been also a secret pedophile?
I don't think so. I think he was... I don't think his problems were in any way sexual. He was... there was never any indication of any of that stuff. I think he was a man, there was no violence in him. I don't even think, in a bizarre way, I don't think there's any malice in him. He was just incredibly narcissistic and needy. And he knew, with his intelligence, he knew that he was incomplete. And he was always looking for something to complete him. So we were dragged from church to church. And, you know, for 3 months we were Catholics, and then we were kind of Church of Scotland, and then for a long time we were Mormons. And you know, the great irony of Derek Cross. I mean, he was a powerful, powerful racist, and I was kind of brought up in the kind of doctrine of his racism. But the one thing that he'd never tried, I think, by this point in his life, was not being a racist. So Derek Cross, the great white supremacist, actually fell in love with, ran away with, and left us with a black woman.
Oh, all right.
That's the degree to which he changed his.
Did he get you into college?
No. I was. He was.